please take a moment to greet one another. I believe that the most that I've ever baptized on a single day were five. And that would have been the Morby family. Well, now we get some more of the Morby family. And wouldn't you know, three baptisms in one day. The Walbrin family as well. That's all very good. Welcome to you all. And today we're going to see reason for us to rejoice. And besides baptism, how about that? With that, we'll begin with the first hymn. Condemned to eternal death. But Jesus took away our sin by giving his life on the cross. In baptism, he clothes us with his righteousness and gives us new life. Our sinful nature need not control us any longer. As baptized children of God, we confess our sins. Holy and merciful Father,
I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner.
God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Savior Jesus commanded baptism when he said, "Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Scripture makes plain the need for baptism. As children of Adam, we belong to a fallen race. From our parents, we inherit a sinful nature, and we would be lost forever unless delivered by our Lord Jesus Christ. He willingly took on himself the curse of sin, and by his death on the cross, he redeemed us and all people. It is the Father's will that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and he will raise them up at the last day. Christ's almighty word gives baptism its power to save. Jesus promises in the last chapter of Mark, whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. The Apostle Peter declares, baptism now saves you. Scripture also teaches that the power and promise of baptism are intended for young and old alike. On the day of Pentecost, Peter testified, the promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. By water and the Spirit, we are born again and are united with Christ and his people as members of the church. Let us pray. Holy God, gracious Father, through your stern judgment, the unbelieving world was destroyed by the flood. But according to your great mercy, you saved Noah and his family. You engulfed stubborn Pharaoh's army in the waters of the Red Sea, but led your people through those same waters to safety on dry land. In the waters of the Jordan, your own Son was baptized and anointed with the Spirit. By those signs, you foreshadowed the washing that you give us in holy baptism. Holding firmly to your command and promises, we ask that you look with favor on these children. Through this water of baptism, drown in them all sin inherited from Adam and any evil they may do. Set them apart from the unbelieving world and hold them safe and secure in the holy ark of the church. Keep them always fervent in spirit and joyful in hope, so that they may honor your holy name and at last receive, together with all your people, the promised inheritance of eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. With that, if those with the baptism children would come forward. According to St. Mark, people were bringing little children to Jesus for him to place his hands on them, but the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant, He said to them, let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly, I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. And he took the children in his arms, placed his hands on them, and blessed them. Lillian Lee Powell Wolf, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
That's exactly what I did when I was a little
Elijah Hunter. The journey, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Natalie Marie, journey, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
This way.
Receive the sign of the cross on the head and the heart. Marking you as a redeemed child of Christ the Crucified. The Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ has given you a new birth of water and the Spirit and has forgiven all your sins. May he strengthen you with his grace all the days of your life. Peace be with you. Let us pray. Merciful Father in heaven, we thank you for the gift of baptism by which you wash away sin and give us a new life and eternal life. Help us each day to remember that through our baptism, you clothe us with Christ, that we may stand holy and righteous before you. Look with favor on Lillian, Natalie, and Elijah, that they may be kept safe by the gift of your Spirit, grow daily in your grace, and live forever by the power of the risen Christ. Make us willing to carry out our responsibilities to all the baptized, so that all may finally come to the blessed joys of heaven through Jesus our Lord. Amen. We continue with the next hymn.
Thank you. children?
Yeah.
So, Amelia. So children, imagine if you pretend you're in a courtroom and you've done something really bad. You've done something really bad and you know that the judge is going to say, guilty. And so you're really worried about that you're going to be found guilty. And suddenly your lawyer goes up to the judge and whispers something in his ear. And the judge smiles at you. And then he says, not guilty. Wow, that'd be terrific. But it would never happen in a real court. But it does happen in God's court. Because you see, Jesus is our lawyer, and Jesus is the one who goes and says to God the Father, you can't call them guilty because I already paid for their sins. I already died for them on the cross. And because of that, we are not guilty in God's sight. In fact, God tells us that Jesus is the atoning sacrifice, the one who sacrificed himself to make us one with him, and not only for us, but for the sins of the whole world. And so, when we do stand before Jesus someday, he's going to say, come, inherit the kingdom prepared for you before I even created the world. Most wonderful thing, all because Jesus loves us that much. So, with that, that ought to be fun. Maybe that one's for Dad. Jesus describes the end of times for our world, but we Christians are to stand firm believing in him. Our gospel lesson for today is recorded in the gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 21, beginning with the fifth verse. Please rise. Some of his disciples were remarking about how the temple was adorned with beautiful stones and with gifts dedicated to God. But Jesus said, as for what you see here, the time will come when not one stone will be left on another. Every one of them will be thrown down. Teacher, they asked, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign that they are about to take place? He replied, watch out that you are not deceived, for many will come in my name claiming I am he, and the time is near. Do not follow them. When you hear of wars and uprisings, do not be frightened. These things must happen first, but the end will not come right away.
Then he said to them, nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, famines, and pestilences in various places, and the fearful events and great signs from heaven. But before all this, they will seize you and persecute you. They will hand you over to the synagogues and put you in prison. And you will be brought before kings and governors, and all on account of my name. And so you will bear testimony to me. But make up your mind not to worry beforehand how you will defend yourselves. For I will give you words and wisdom that none of your adversaries will be able to resist or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents, brothers and sisters, relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. Everyone will hate you because of me, but not a hair of your head will perish. Stand firm, and you will win life. This is the gospel of our Lord. We pray, gracious Lord, our refuge and strength, pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep them steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort them in all temptations. Defend them against all their enemies, and bestow on the church your saving peace through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated now as we continue with the next hymn.
Thank you.
peace be multiplied unto you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The word of God that we'll consider is Malachi chapter 4, the very last chapter of the Old Testament of the Bible. Look, the day is coming, burning like a blast furnace. All the arrogant and every evildoer will be stubble. The day that is coming will set them on fire, says the Lord of armies. A day that will not leave behind a root or a branch for them. But for you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness will rise, and there will be healing in its wings. You will go out and jump like calves from the stall. You will trample the wicked. They will surely be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day when I take action, says the Lord of armies. Remember the law of my servant Moses, which I commanded to him at Horeb, to serve as statutes and judgments over all Israel. Look, I am going to send Elijah the prophet to you before that great and fearful day of the Lord comes. He will turn the hearts of fathers to their children, and the hearts of the children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and strike the land with complete destruction. This is the word of God. Dear friends in Christ Jesus, our only Lord and Savior, many men and women in Wisconsin have been making plans to rejoice in the coming weeks, but not because of Thanksgiving, but rather because of deer hunting. But of course, there is also that hope that they'll take the time to thank the Lord, whether in worship services as a setting or not, to thank the Lord for all of his goodness to us, especially in sending our dear Savior Jesus. Well, today we are going to see that there is reason for us to rejoice. And yet, as we consider this, the very first reason that Malachi gives us is one that might not be something we'd think of as reason to rejoice. Judgment Day is coming for all the wicked. Before we talk about Judgment Day and what will happen to the wicked, I want you to take notice of the Bible translation that I used for this today, the Evangelical Heritage Version, and the fact that it uses a term here that most of us aren't that familiar with. The Lord of Armies. It calls it the Lord of Armies rather than the Lord of Hosts. And I'd be willing to bet that even though when you read your Bibles and you see the Lord of Hosts listed over and over again, and you might very well think of those hosts as the hosts of angels of heaven, you don't necessarily think of them as armies. And yet that's what they are. They are ruthless fighters and protectors of us each and every day. Even though you and I don't see them, they're fighting on behalf of us all the time, trying to make sure that we stay safe and secure in the hands of the Lord. We think of this especially, you know, armies. Armies? Well, we think of this past Friday, Veterans Day. And we thank the Lord for the veterans, right? We think, you may or may not realize that November the 11th of 1918 was the end of World War I. And from that point on, this country has observed Veterans Day as a day to thank the Lord that he has given us men and women that are willing to fight for us and our country to keep our freedoms alive. Well, as we thank the Lord for veterans that serve in our armies and other, we also thank the Lord for the veterans of angels that fight for us on a regular basis. The fact is that we also talk about that if we follow Martin Luther's morning or evening prayers, as we have been taught, let your holy angel be with me that the wicked foe may have no power over me. But there are multitudes in our world that don't recognize that there are angels. It's amazing to me how there are so many that recognize ancient aliens these days, and yet they don't recognize that the Lord and his angels are ones that have taken part in our history of our entire world all along. They're there, whether people admit it or not. So Malachi begins this last chapter of the Old Testament telling us of God's plan as to what he'll do to all wickedness. Look, the day is coming, burning like a blast furnace. All the arrogant and every evildoer will be stubble. The day that is coming will set them on fire, says the Lord of armies, a day that will not leave behind a root or a branch for them. Doesn't it seem that so often the ones who do wickedness or do evil or don't do good are the ones that seem to get by easy in this world? While those of us who believe in Jesus have a rough time of it. Well, rest assured that you're not the first person to think that way. There are plenty of passages in the Bible that would indicate the same thing is going on. The fact is that we've been studying the book of Revelation, John's Revelation, in Bible class, and there's plenty of evidence there that not only are the wicked thriving, but they're going to thrive even more and more as we get closer and closer to the end of the world. Not a pretty picture of what we want to see for the future. Well, regarding this very thing, the psalmist Asaph wrote in Psalm 73, when I tried to understand this, it was very troubling to me. Until I went to the sanctuary of God, then I understood their end. Surely you placed them on slippery places. You caused them to fall into destruction. How quickly they come to ruin, completely destroyed by terrors. They are like a dream when someone wakes up. So when you arise, O Lord, you will despise them like an illusion. Oh, but wait a minute. Malachi doesn't mention believer versus unbeliever here. He instead says it'll be the end of the arrogant and every evildoer. Realize that every time you or I challenge God, every time we sin, we're basically saying to the Almighty, I know better than you, God. I know the right things to do. I'll do it my way. And my way, God, you should listen to me. It would be much better if you listened to me, because that way you would know what's the best way to go about things. How arrogant can we be to take such a position against the Lord God Almighty every day of our lives? And yet we do that. We challenge him. We stand opposed to him. Are we not part of the arrogant then and the evildoers? The fact is that God should certainly see us that way too. Can you say that you have not done evil? Can you really say that you have not challenged God? In fact, there are times when you or I might very well start thinking, well, God, you'd better listen to me or I'm going to get angry at you. And we do it sometimes. How dare we talk of arrogance? And yet, that's how we should be classified. But we look forward to what that psalmist Asaph was talking about, and what Malachi says here too, in the rising of the Lord, as the sun of righteousness with healing in its wings. Or maybe we should put it the other way, S-O-M of righteousness with healing in his wings when he arises. The fact is that Malachi wrote as a conclusion of the Old Testament, as any of the Old Testament prophets spoke of things, always looking at the mountain peaks without really knowing that there are valleys in between. He spoke as though he knew exactly what was coming. Yes, he did, according to the Lord himself. But he didn't know that there would be an entire New Testament era in between Christ's first coming and his second. Just for a moment, think of how excited you children, I'm talking to you children for a moment here. Think of how excited you are that there's a certain day coming up next month, right? Called Christmas. Or maybe it's your children that are that way, or your grandchildren who are thinking that way, or even great-grandchildren, whatever it might be. Well, for that matter, it's you and me too, right? We get excited about Christmas too. Well, if we get excited, that eager with anticipation over this one day of the year, how much more so when we get to actually look up because our redemption is drawing near. Fact is that Judgment Day will bring us ultimate joy. Malachi put it this way: you will go out and jump around like calves from the stall. You will trample the wicked. They will surely be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day when I take action, says the Lord of armies. Instead of dreading the day that the Lord will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, we anticipate it. We long for it. We speak of it in our creeds. And while the Lord's enemies, who are also our enemies and the enemies of all of God's people, will face their Maker, and so will we, we recognize that they will get what's coming to them. They will get what they deserve. And you and I will get what we don't deserve. They will get punishment for their sins, for rejecting the only Savior of the world. And we who believe in that only Savior, even though we deserve the same punishment in hell, we'll receive everlasting bliss and life eternal, all because of the Lord Jesus and what he has done for us. That day will make us so joyous that Malachi says we'll leap like calves that are let out of the stalls for the first time in the springtime, jumping around like crazy. Recall how God tells us through Paul's letter to the Romans not to take revenge, but leave room for God's vengeance. He says, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Well, that day is coming, and it will bring so much horror for those who will wish that the mountains would fall on them but it will bring everlasting joy for us who believe in the Lord Jesus. That leads us to one more point that Malachi makes here. Judgment Day brings us together. I would guess that you have a hope concerning that Christmas coming or Thanksgiving meal that's coming. I would be willing to bet you have this hope down deep inside that your whole family will get together and you're all going to enjoy peace and perfect harmony with one another. No more problems, no more griefs, no more troubles. The dream on. Oh, you'll probably try to get together. Many will. And there'll be those that, for one reason or other, they weren't able to make it. And then there'll be those other ones who do show up, like you, and we find something to argue about. And so that wonderful, perfect gathering together doesn't wind up to be quite so perfect as what one might think, even though we've got that beautiful picture in mind of what it's going to be like. Well, what we're really dreaming of, it isn't a perfect Christmas gathering on this earth. What we're really dreaming about is the perfect gathering that we'll have with the Lord Jesus. Malachi tells us, remember the law of my servant Moses, which I commanded to him at Horeb to serve as statutes and judgments over all Israel. Look, I am going to send Elijah the prophet to you before that great and fearful day of the Lord comes. He will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and strike the land with complete destruction. Well, we recognize that as far as that prophet Elijah coming is concerned, the Lord Jesus tells us that pointed to John the Baptist. And of course, John did come before Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, came to this earth. But now, looking beyond that, looking to the rest of the point, he says, remember the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, the ones written by Moses. He says, turn to those, search them, study them. And what will happen is you'll draw closer together in faith, closer together with each other as you remember God's word. Those first five books of the Bible, well, they would point us also to what happened today when we enjoyed seeing the fulfillment again of go baptize all nations. What a wondrous thing! But Malachi says, look beyond the baptism. Look beyond the baptism. And remember that Jesus also said to teach them everything that Christ commanded. Fathers and mothers, bring up your children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. And make sure, as Moses said in the first five books of the Bible, talk about that word of God on the road and when you're at home. Bring it up to your children on a regular basis. Train a child in the way that he or she should go. And when they are old, they will not turn from it. That's what the psalmist says concerning this. You know, years ago, there was an old saying that a lot of people knew. In fact, they even made little electric plates that you could put on your light switches that said, the family that prays together stays together. Make that your motto. Stay together with the Lord. Listen to what the Lord has to say. And you will stay much, much closer, not only to the Lord, but to each other as well. You and I need the Lord, his love, his forgiveness, his word, Make that a part of each and every day of your life. And listen to the Lord Jesus as he says, come to me. Then we will all have reason to rejoice. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Continue with the next hymn. Strengthen the faith of all who are weak and wandering.
Give us power to live in your faithful people.
Your saints will triumph forever in new heavens and a new earth. The sound of weeping and crying will be heard no more. We anticipate with joy an eternity of perfect fellowship with you.
Be with us as we work and witness for Christ, so that many more can join us before your throne.
Lord, we come before you and ask that you would watch over Chris Grosshams as she faces surgery soon. We also ask that you would continue to bless Lloyd Warden so that soon he will be back with us in worship. And we ask that you would watch over all of our sick or shut-ins, that all may continue to trust in you, their dear Savior. And hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Lord of life, the day is coming when you will come down from heaven with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet call of God. On that glorious day, the saints triumphant will no longer need a building in which to praise you, for we will see you face to face. On that glorious day, the saints triumphant will rise in bright array, clothed in your perfect righteousness.
Give us strength and joy. We will share fully in the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We conclude now with the final hymn. Again, and welcome to you all. Note the announcements. I call attention to the planned giving sheets that are in the back that you could make suggestions on what we do with $20,000 specifically from our funds. The military support group ammo tin is out there once again too, since we just went past Veterans Day. We remember those who are serving in our armed forces and give them a little help. Praise the Lord, we raised over $450 for the Early Childhood Center in at Good Shepherd in Beloit. And we also gave $1,500 to our Pakistan missions through our chili cook-off that took place last Sunday. Congratulations to Paul Moore for that. next Sunday, the regular, and then a week and a half from now, our Thanksgiving evening service on the Wednesday evening. I'm going to preach on alphabet soup. And it's also the deadline for the early bird special for leadership conference. This week, there are the various things going on. And certainly anyone is welcome to join us also for that Bible information class. I'm not sure about the choir, though. Is that going to be at 9? It will this time. Oh, it's in December when you had the other conflict. Okay. All right. There. So with that, I believe those are all the announcements other than there's the food. You make the fellowship. Have yourself a good day.